Hello, everyone. Happy Wednesday. Thank you for tuning into another episode of the Win in STEM podcast. For our first-time listeners, Win in STEM is a platform to highlight successful people of color STEMinists to show others how to get a seat at the table and win in science, technology, engineering, and math. Man, can y'all believe we've reached the halfway point of the year? Time is flying. But, you know, this gives us the opportunity to apply what we've learned during the first half of the year to the second half. And I'm hoping you'll learn a lot from this episode. Today's episode is titled, Are We Talkin Teams? Shout out to Drake for the inspo and sponsoring this episode. My special guest and I will be discussing the importance of coaching, mentoring, and sponsorship. I have Duane Rollins with me here today. He is actually one of my coaches from the Peak Performance Accelerator program I did earlier this year. He's currently the Director of Product Management at Capital One. So thank you, Duane, for being here today.
Yeah, thank you for having me. And I'm just like so impressed, like already as I hear the intro, I'm like, ooh, like this is gonna be special.
Thank you. So Duane, on my podcast, I like my guests to introduce themselves. I want this to be a time for you to showcase your accomplishments, success, share with our listeners who you are, what you do. I give you full permission to brag about yourself. This is your time to shine. The floor is yours.
Hi, thank you. Bragging about myself is always hard. Like people is like, tell me about yourself. And I'm like, hi, I'm Duane. And that's like usually the extent that I want to give. But for context, given it is both Win and STEM, when we're talking about coaching, I'll go to some of my background. I like to think of myself as a creative problem solver. I have used my skills in design to kind of navigate many different spaces from working in startups, working for startups, working in the federal government, working at large Fortune 100 like organizations. I've been working with some of the largest and most impactful impact-driven organizations around the world, helping them with their digital strategy. It's been just a wild ride thus far. So my background is mechanical engineering, shifted to industrial design, started doing data visualization, moved into UX, then did some instructional design, measurement evaluation, and now I'm in product management. So what that really like says to me is that, you know, there's no one set path to anybody's career, and particularly with STEM. It gives you so many different options. And what I've done is really just taken advantage of all the options in front of me and try to solve some of the most important problems to me. So those are like kind of like my professional background. On the side, I really got into coaching through my love of teaching. And I've taught at every level from, you know, kindergarten to working adults. And it's been just a fascinating journey to see how people learn. And through that whole process, not only are you teaching people, you also learn a lot more yourself because you have to master materials. So like coaching and teaching has really opened my eyes to like just the subject matter when it comes to UX design or like just personal development. And it's forced me to do some deep reflection and consideration of how I approach those things and how I want to show up in the world. And so that's a little bit about like my background.
Awesome. Thank you for that lovely introduction. So let's dive in. So today's episode, once again, titled, Are We Talkin Teams? And the importance of coaching, mentoring, and sponsorship. Can you tell us the difference between those three and the importance of them?
Yeah, so all those three things are important when it comes to coaching, mentorship, and sponsorship. And I look at them for different aspects of like the goals and outcomes that you're trying to achieve. I'll start with mentorship because I think that's what most people are familiar with. Mentorship, the way I like to define it, is about both inspiration and seeing beyond like who you are, right? Understanding that there's a different place to get to in the world and there's a person in a relationship that you start to cultivate in order to help you get there, right? So usually it's based on the experiences that they had, and they're trying to push you down a pathway that they either trailblaze themselves or somebody close to them have. So it's about like this guidance in a sense. Coaching for me is a little bit different, because coaching is not just about guidance. It's really about you working on yourself and getting better in some particular skill or attribute, right? So a mentor may help you see the world differently, whereas a coach will help you perform better in the world. Outside of that, there's sponsorship. You usually see it in the corporate settings or like large organizations, but these are people who are advocating for you and not just saying you're a great person, but saying you're a great person to the right people when you're not in the room to provide more opportunities for you to showcase who you are and to move up, right? And using the organization. So sponsorship is a little bit different relationship from a mentorship or coach. It's not about necessarily your performance. It's not about them inspiring you to, get better at what you're doing. Mm-hmm. It's really about providing more opportunity for you to showcase like who you already are and the ways that you've already shown up in the world and, for some of the things that you've already done. So that's how I think of those things for myself.
Awesome. Okay. So now that we've got a breakdown, let's dive into each one of them. So let's talk about coaching first. So we know that there's different types of coaches. We have fitness coaches, business, professional development coaches. How would one know they need a coach versus a mentor? Because I know sometimes their roles might intersect. So what are some key questions a person should ask themselves to know that, hey, do I need a coach or do I need a mentor?
Yeah. So to me, coaching is always about performance. So you need a coach when you're looking at a skill set that you want to build and say, I want to get better at something, right? So you think of a health coach, it's like, hey, or a fitness coach, I want to be more fit, right? So you get a coach to help you through that process, develop routines, habits, understand how to be more effective and efficient at your time to reach some outsized outcome due to the effort that you're put in. So coaching is really when you want to get better. Mentorship, right, is when you're really looking for guidance, right? It's not necessarily about getting better. It's more about getting perspective. Mm. And if you're looking for like perspective and you're looking for an opportunity to bounce ideas or bounce, thoughts or bounce like aspirations off of someone who maybe have been down that path or have done something similar, mentorship is a really good option for you because it's an incredible way to gain perspective, right, of the world and maybe make sense of what's in front of you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So let's say if someone is maybe considering coaching, what are some things that should be in their mindset or their attitude to know that they're really ready to take on a coach?
Yeah. So you're ready to take on the coach when you're ready to do the work, right? Mm-hmm. And you're ready for the change. So you will not get any benefit from a coach if you don't want to do the work, like full stop, mm-hmm. right? Because you can develop a plan for somebody. You can tell them exactly what they need to do, but you can't really make somebody do anything that they aren't willing to do. And I think there was a great quote that I heard recently, like on TV, where it was like some people mistake habit for hard work. Mm-hmm. And those aren't the same thing, right? You can get up and do something all the time consistently, but you still may not be working hard at it. Mm-hmm. And I think with a coach, you need to be ready to put in that work, right? If you want to get the most like out of that relationship.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. And one thing I like to add for coaching to work after you get that mindset, you also need to set goals for yourself and the direction that you want to get out of and make sure that, whatever coach that you choose to pursue, that you trust them because a lot of these coaches, it's an investment, right? You have to be willing to invest, and you have to realize that if you invest in a coach, what is your return? So getting that mind shift on your goals that you want to pursue, the direction you want to go to, and the trust within your coach, definitely need to take that all into consideration.
Yeah, and that's a beautiful way of putting it, because again, coaching is about performance. And if you don't know how you want to improve, right, or why that's meaningful to you, it's going to be very hard for you to really take full advantage of that mm-hmm. type of relationship and get the return on investment from going out and finding a coach for you.
Mm-hmm. So now let's dive into mentoring. What advice would you give to a prospective mentee who is looking to find a mentor and to start that conversation? Because I know there might be college students who are looking for professionals to be a mentor, or there might be professionals who are looking for mentors in their workforce and their job doesn't have a set mentoring program. So what would you suggest to kind of find a mentor and initiate that conversation?
Yeah. So there's two like broader points that I'll bring up, which is first, like mentorship is a two-way relationship, right? Mm-hmm. So the idea is that if somebody takes you on as a mentor, what they hope to see is you progress and get better because of that relationship, yep. right? And you should come in with the idea that you'll be able to give by being consistent and showing up, but also applying the things that they're kind of telling you and applying that perspective to like your day-to-day life. So I think it's really important to remember that mentorship is a two-way relationship. And you should mm-hmm. be looking for somebody that's going to be willing to pour into you, but they should also be, you know, able to challenge you, right, to apply those things. So you're not just like listening and taking no action like on it at all. Mm-hmm. And then when you think of like mentorship, like more broadly, what you want to keep in mind is that you don't just want to be mentored by somebody that you don't respect. Right. Mm-hmm. And they can have achieved things, but if you don't respect them, it's not going to be a really good relationship. And so you're looking for somebody that not only has moved in ways that you maybe admire or ways that you want to get to, but you also respect the way that they got there. Mm-hmm. Because that's just going to, you know, again, help you really build like a deeper bond and mm-hmm. see each other there. But, and I will also say like, get a mentor that's actually done it and not one, not somebody who's just talked about it. Because mm-hmm. a lot of people that talk, is very few people have done, like, and as many doers in the world. So again, look for somebody that's like action oriented. But if you yourself are action oriented and remember that it's a two-way street, it'll be a much better like relationship that you build with a mentor, and it'll be more desirable to take you on, because a mentor, you know, everybody wants to be with a winner, right? Or they want to be with somebody that's showing potential or opportunity. And you want to make sure that you're showcasing yourself as such and finding somebody that has taken advantage of those opportunities that you would want to like emulate will be a good thing to look for in a mentor.
So you mentioned that mentoring is a two-way street. So we know mm-hmm. the mentee can get a lot of benefit, but what does the mentor get out of it? I know seeing someone grow advance, but it's a time commitment. Sometimes it's an emotional drain. What does or what should the mentor be expecting out of this type of relationship?
Yeah, and for the most part, most mentor-mentee relationship, they're separated by age in one generally thing, like generally speaking, the one thing that's really different as you get older in age is the amount of free time you have. And mm-hmm. so they are looking to like maximize like that time, like with you and making sure that they're effective, right, during like those moments. So I think when it comes to like those relationships overall, it's figuring out, you know, how to like both like maximize that time. So when you think about what a mentor gets out of a relationship, just a two-way street, is kind of like a gardener, right? Where they want to see something blossom. They want to see something grow. So the idea is that they're tending and caring and pouring into you with the idea that you grow. And oftentimes this is valuable because they got to where they are due to the kindness, the perspective, the word share, the encouragement, that they got from somebody else. So it's an opportunity for them to give back oftentimes what was given to them. Mm-hmm. So I would look at, you know, the idea of like ultimately what you want from any type of relationship as a mentor is that person to blossom and to grow and to become a, you know, better version of themselves, or, you know, end up in better situations because you took the time to, you spent some time with them and you were able to give them perspective.
Oh, I like that. I like that analogy, gardening. Now let's look into sponsorship. This is one of my favorite topics. I think it's not really spoken about in, you know, the Black and Brown communities. I feel like this is like a hidden secret that our white counterparts know about, but our community doesn't really know or talk about. So for sponsorship, why is it so important in the Black and Brown communities, in corporate America, and in academia?
Yeah, this is a concept that I was completely blind to until actually a few years ago. Like, it just never was like on my radar. But sponsorship, and you hear about it a lot more, and again, larger organizations. But what I like to think of it is really smart people, right? And people who are in large orgs, when they're making decisions, they make it based on data, right? And they look at the quality of data that they're getting in that informs their decision making. So if they want to go right or left, they'll usually try to get some input, figure out what's the quality data, and then use the best data to make a decision. Sponsorship is about somebody providing quality data on you, right? When they're in that diligence process, when they're thinking about who to promote, who to provide leadership opportunities to, who to give new opportunities to. They're the person that's going to be in the room that you may not be in, but they will advocate on your behalf. Or when things need to move, they're able to, they have relationships and they're able in those organizations to move things. So that way you can get something that is like of value to you. So I think sponsorship, and it's probably because I hadn't worked in really large organizations and I hadn't really understood it fully as a concept, but it's somebody who is going to be speaking on your behalf when you're not in the room and actively looking for opportunities for you to either showcase like what you can do, right? Or put you in a position that maybe you should have been in given what you've already produced.
Definitely. So when I usually think of sponsorship, the phrase "it's not what you know, it's who you know or who knows you" comes to my mind, because you don't know who is speaking your name in the conference rooms, in the big meetings, and before you step into an interview. And sponsorship is very, it's a huge key, a major key that is needed in our communities, especially if you look at all these big companies, look at the board of directors, the C-suites, there's not much people of color up there, you know? And I think that the way for us to rise up in these corporations is through sponsorship. If you have, you know, a key role in an organization and you spot a person of color who is killing the game, open the doors for them, you know, find opportunities for them to step up so they can hopefully one day take your place or get to your level one day so we can see more representation, because we definitely need it, STEM.
Yeah, you definitely need it. And if you're looking for sponsorship, what I would suggest is make it easy to tell your story, right? And a lot of people forget that because, again, they're going to be speaking on your behalf oftentimes when you're not there, or advocating for you when you're not there. And you want to make it as easy as possible for them to pull up examples of when you delivered in a major way, or the types of projects that you've been working on, or the leadership stuff that you're doing, or the side of desk stuff. So what happens is that some people get so caught up in trying to drive like in performance and trying to drive results that they're doing a lot, but they're not necessarily, there's not a really easy way to talk about what they do, right? And because you're close to work, you can see like what it is and why it's important, but everybody else may not be able to. So think about how you can make it easier for other people to tell your story, whether you put out you know, a weekly or monthly like email to like certain people where, like, hey, here's what we accomplished with our team like this month, right? Or this quarter, you know, you keeping a list of the things that you delivered on, anything you can do to make it very easy for somebody to go in and advocate for you and tell your story is what you should be focused on when it comes to sponsorship. And for people of color, again, it's not that they're going to just have the perfect words to tell your story. You have to help them on that journey. And the people who get like really, really great sponsorship, they make it really easy to tell their story of their results, accomplishments, performance, and how they deliver results.
So sponsorship is kind of performance-based. Is it something that we can ask someone to be a sponsor after performing well? Or is it something that we just have to continue performing and wait till a sponsor seeks us out?
It depends on the culture, right? But yes, you can definitely ask for it, right? In most places, like, hey, would you want to be my sponsor? Some organizations have like a very formal like a relationship with the idea of sponsorship, others maybe not so much. So it might not be that you're asking them to be a sponsor. You just say, hey, can we have a regular pull up, right? Where I can get you up to date on like what we're doing, particularly if they're like in your tower or your team. Maybe again, it's just the email that you send that, you know, has all of your accomplishments. I know sometimes in a lot of companies, when they go in a performance review, you can help the people that's advocating for you, whether it's for, you know, promotion or for bonus, you just arm them with talking points so they can make the case for you. Because nobody's going to make the case better for yourself than you. So, yeah. But some organizations, there's a formal relationship. Sometimes it's just a matter of like that person knows you and they know what you do. So it's not just, hey, this is a cool person. They also know what you're doing when it comes to the work.
After you find a sponsor, how do you be vulnerable with them? I feel as if, you know, mentoring, you have a relationship with that person, so you're more prone to be open with them. But for a sponsor, I feel as if, you know, they see you from afar, so they may not know you as deeply as a mentor. But let's say a sponsor comes up to you and there's an opportunity that opened up and they thought of you. How do you let them know that you can't perform, or how do you show your weakness to them, or should you show your weakness or not?
Yeah. And I want to call it weakness. It's like, you know, you might know where you have areas to improve and develop, right? So instead of saying like, how do I be vulnerable and show my weakness? It's how do you, I would say like, how do you make an ask for opportunities to improve upon your areas of improvement, right? So you might go to them and maybe you want to get better at communication, right? And that's the area that you feel like you need the most help. So instead of saying like, hey, I'm bad at communicating, you might say like, hey, do you know of any classes, courses, or resources about making great presentations? Because I've seen this presentation that you gave, I thought was amazing. Like, where did that come from? So I think that's a better way of framing it, right? So that way it's about helping you overcome those things, because what you don't want to do is just shift your own vulnerabilities onto other people, right? It's okay to be vulnerable, but you don't want to be vulnerable in ways that you're just shifting it to them and say, hey, you carry that and make it better for me, right? So I think that's like the key difference that I would keep in mind, and the key framing that I would keep in mind is that it's areas for opportunities and you're looking for ways to get better. So you're coming to them with an ask of, what are some things you can do to continue to improve in that area?
Makes sense. So in this virtual environment, I know some are saying that outside is opening, but a lot of companies are still working virtually. So what do you think about mentoring sponsorship relationships in this new normal? And what tips do you have about these virtual relationships? For example, someone like myself working from home, right? Starting a new job. And I know visibility might be a little difficult to find a sponsor, even mentor, since a lot of us is not in the office. A lot of us are still, you know, working from home. So how do we navigate these type of relationships virtually?
Yeah. So there's one big thing that you got to do virtually that I find people don't do enough, and that's turn on your camera.
Yeah.
Right? It sounds like a small thing, but oftentimes what you'll see is that so many people that hop into these meetings and their camera will be off. And you're like, well, how do I get visibility? Well, that's the one thing that you can do, because it's actually much easier now to get visibility in that regard. You may not always be able to add value with solutions, but you can always add value with asking questions, right? Mm-hmm. So being willing to like speak up in those settings and ask those questions. So, you know, you can always think of like when there's a big talk going on and like, let's say the CEO is like talking to everybody and giving, you know, some insight, direction of the company, and they open it up for Q&A. Be willing to step up and ask a question, right? And don't wing it. Don't come in like and just say like, hey, I'm gonna just go shoot off the hip. Prepare. Think of something that's like very like relevant and pertinent, right? And take some time and maybe have a couple different ones, or if you listen to the talk, come up with something like this meaningful, but be willing to ask those questions is a really good way to get visible. Now, those are all like really small, like tactical things, right? A lot of people are thinking like much more broader and bigger. It's like, how do I, you know, really showcase the work that I'm doing? So what I would say is like, look at the forms you have for like demoing the work and being the presenter, like on that, ask for meetings with people at higher levels than you, right? Like, so people that are above you, like skip levels and ask for meetings with those individuals so you can talk about like the work and what's happening. And then the last part is just volunteer. Ask, you know, when there's opportunities and somebody needs to step up and do something, volunteer. Like, so with me, I recently just started like at my new organization. And one of the first things I did was volunteer to be a facilitator for the performance management, right? Mm-hmm. I hadn't done it before. I couldn't, but it made sense for me to facilitate because I would learn more. And it was also true where I wouldn't just sit in the background without much to say, because I don't know many of the employees. So I can't speak to their strengths or weaknesses and, you know, areas for opportunity. So like, that's a great way to, you know, that's an example of a way that you can continue to give yourself more visibility that, hey, you exist, is by, you know, again, volunteering for some of those like things that are related to the work, but may not be the actual work itself, but is important to making the organization function well.
Yeah, I definitely agree. Reaching out, doing skip level meetings. At my job, I joined the Black Employee Resource Group, and I found out that one of the regional directors of the ERG sits at my site. So I sent her a meeting notice just to introduce myself, since we'll be working together in that platform in the future. And having that 10-15 minute conversation, I learned so much about her. We had so much similarities. We worked with the same company in the past, different locations. She was also new to the company. So it was good to, you know, meet people through setting up that meeting. And who knows, that can be a potential sponsor for me in the future. So I'm glad I took that initiative to reach out and get to know who she is and ask about herself and the organization. So I definitely recommend that.
I think that's just a beautiful thing. It really speaks to like who you are, right? That you actually went and took the initiative. And I think one thing to remember too is that people get credit for, you know, identifying top talent, right? Mm-hmm. And helping like elevate them. So that's a part of like your role as you get hired too, is to be like, oh, this person is good. And if they can get you to another role and you perform in that role, that makes them look even better too.
Yeah, they get the credit too.
So it's like it's a win-win situation, like when it comes to like sponsorship and finding, you know, people who are like hungry and oftentimes who are overlooked, who have been performing really well, but they haven't been given the opportunity at a different scale to really showcase what they can do. So yeah, always look for opportunities to just ask, right, and initiate those conversations and see where they lead.
Yeah, ask and turn the camera on, guys. Turn the camera on.
Yeah, turn the camera on. Like they need to see your face. This is the easiest time to get FaceTime with leaders, because again, most people just have it off in the background. Now, I will say I've never wanted more phone conference calls than now, when everything is like video, where I'm just like, can we go back to like the phone conference calls?
Can we go back to Skype?
But it is like inherently better, and it feels more human as you're talking to another face. So I encourage you to do that.
Nice. Let's put some real world examples behind coaching, mentor, and sponsor relationships. Has there been a time in your life, Duane, where you've had a coach who's helped you change your mindset, or a mentor who's helped you advance or learn something, or a sponsor that's opened up a door for you?
Short answer is like, yes. But I'll also say I probably got it more from the people that I've coached and or mentored and or sponsored in some way, because mm-hmm. I think I've learned more from like their fresh perspective and the way they've looked at stuff and approached the world. So, yes, I have definitely been like supported in many different ways. The first and most important way I think mentorship has helped is helping you understand like your worth, right? And so when it comes to like looking at the job market, it's often hard to know how much you should be getting paid, right? Mm-hmm. And what makes sense. And if you having a mentor usually gives you a space to ask that direct question and get more perspective on, hey, what should I be asking for? What is the actual range or type of compensation I should be looking for? Because mm-hmm. you may be like leaving thousands of dollars on the table by just not coming prepared with like information that could easily be have gotten in the conversation. So I think mentorship has helped in that way, very specifically for me, and just helping me understand my worth and knowing what to ask for and understanding what I could advocate for.
Definitely. It's very beneficial to have a coach, mentor, sponsor in your community to kind of help you see things that you weren't able to see, or like you said about, you know, the pay scale, giving you information that you normally would not know, and just to help enlighten you and give you information.
Yeah, and just the confidence to go in there and mm-hmm. do it, right? Because you need to be audacious and bold, right? To make some of these asks or be like, hey, like I'm worth more, or you know, I can do more. Mm-hmm. So, you know, sometimes you just need those individuals to put the battery in your back, so to speak, yeah. to go out there and just ask and advocate for yourself.
Exactly, exactly. So, Duane, I know during the PP3 program, you're always spitting out resources, if it's a book, a movie, a podcast, something. Do you have any resources or your favorite resources that you recommend for those seeking a coach, mentor, or a sponsor?
Oh, man. So when it comes to like resources or like books for that, it just depends on, you know, I'm trying to think of like what are the ones that I've actually like used, because that's the hard part, is to say, you know, like here's what hurt somebody else versus like what I've actually done.
Right. Yeah.
So when it comes to like, I think I've been watching, I'm trying to think where the things are recently, because I just haven't been like immersed in it like I used to be. But when it comes like to podcasts, there's a couple of like shows that I think have been like very helpful for me to just understand the impact of like relationships and like how to move in the spaces that are important to me. So I've been reading, you know, a lot about like venture capital and and I know I've also like listened to a lot of people's stories and their journey in the creative careers. So like mm-hmm. Revision Path is a podcast I listen to, which really looks at, you know, creatives of color and their stories and their journeys through various careers. And I think that's been very helpful for me because I'm learning how they navigate it. Right. I'm not just like hearing like what they did and what they accomplished. It's like, well, how did you navigate? And also how did you cope amongst like all those things? So I thought that's been like a really good resource for me to like just hear those things like up front. I also listen to a lot of The Knowledge Project with Shane Parrish. And that, again, is a lot of conversations about people and individuals and hearing their journey. And that's a broader swath of people that's like on that podcast that really, again, talk about their own journey or some topic that they're expert in. Mm-hmm. And I think those are probably like the two like biggest resources that I've used when it comes to like thinking of being coached or mentored or sponsorship. It's hearing other people's stories and then learning how they navigate it. There's also another book by Tim Ferriss and it is Tools of the Titans. And it's a good book that kind of goes through some of his previous like content and interviews, and it pulls like all of those insights out. And then there's another guy that I follow called Naval, and he has a Navalmanac. It's like the Navalmanac.com. You can actually get it for free. And that's a great collection of like his, you know, wisdom and perspective on how to approach like life, career, and investing. And I think all of those like combined give me a lot of like understanding of just how to approach people and relationships, how to leverage mm-hmm. them like for time, and how to think about my skills, right, in the broader marketplace or for the broader good.
Awesome. Awesome. So I know after our listeners listen to this episode, they will definitely be reaching out to you. So where can they connect with you?
Yeah, so the easiest way to connect with me is on Twitter at D-D-O-T Rollins. So D-dot Rollins, D-D-O-T R-O-L-I-N-S. That's probably the easiest way to like connect with me, along with like LinkedIn. So if you look up Duane Rollins on LinkedIn, like I'll come up, and you know, really happy to connect there and again learn more about your journey and where you want to go, and hopefully there's an opportunity to give you some perspective too. I also do write a newsletter too at duane.substack.com.
Happy 1 year.
Yeah, just reached my 1 year anniversary on my newsletter, which I'm very, very, very proud of myself from, because writing isn't my first mode of communication. So I took that journey to start doing that more. But yeah, happy with that. And that's also a nice and beautiful community that I've cultivated there, where I put out a lot of thoughts and perspectives and other just like cool resources and stories that I'm reading. So it's a good way to follow like what's top of mind for me.
Perfect. So I'll definitely add that into the episode description. Highly recommend subscribing to the newsletter, because Duane be coming up with some gems. I'm like, okay, let me add this to my stash. But thank you so much, Duane, for this great discussion. I hope our listeners understand the importance of having a team of coaches, mentors, and sponsors in the Black and Brown communities. Because, you know, in order to see more people like us at the top, we need to prepare those around us and bring them up as we go up. So thank you, Duane, for your input.
Of course, happy to be here. Thanks for having me. And yeah, this is beautiful what you're doing with your community by providing both the lessons that you learned and the lessons from your network, from your coaches, mentors, and sponsors, and friends, like also. So happy that you got to have this convo, and just love everything that you're doing.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And listeners, thank you for tuning in to another episode of the Win and STEM podcast. Make sure you rate 5 stars, like, subscribe on Apple, Spotify, Anchor, Google, Pandora. We're on every platform. Tell a friend to tell a friend to tell a friend. Follow us on Instagram at the Win and STEM podcast, and tag us with your favorite takeaway. Enjoy the rest of the week. But until next time, y'all be great and go out and win in STEM.